Welcome all. In this lecture, I am going to discuss about the time independent Schrödinger equation. So at first look at the equation which is time dependent. So this is the structure of the time dependent Schrödinger equation. So this is ih cut del psi by del t on the left hand side, and in the right hand side this is minus h cut square del square by 2m plus v rt of psi rt. So this is the time dependent Schrödinger equation, and in the first bracket the operator is known as the Hamiltonian operator. So h is equal to minus h cut square del square by 2m plus v of rt. Here v is the potential. Now we will discuss about the Schrödinger equation, which is time independent Schrödinger equation. So there are many physically interesting problems in which the potential energy of the particle does not depend on the time. That is, V is equal to V of R. You see that we have written the potential energy in terms of position only, and potential energy is independent of time. In such cases, the solution of the Schrödinger equation, which I have just shown, that gets considerably simplified, because it is then possible to use the method of separation of variables. This method consists of assuming that the wave function psi r comma t can be written as a product of two functions, a function which is dependent only on position, that is psi of r, and a function that is only time dependent, that is f of t. So we are writing the wave function psi of r comma t is equal to psi r into f t. So if we use the wave function in this way, that is psi r t is equal to psi r into f t, then the Schrödinger equation, which is the time dependent Schrödinger equation, that will become like this. I have already shown the structure of the time dependent Schrödinger equation. So what we have to do, we have to substitute the value of psi in that equation. So then after substituting the value of psi in that equation, we will get the equation in this way, that is on the left hand side I h cut psi r df by dt, and in the right hand side ft, because this operator is only position dependent, so and this will not act on ft. So we can write in this way, that is ft, then h of psi, h means that is the Hamiltonian operator, minus h cut square by 2m del square plus vr, and that will act on psi r. So this is the right hand side and this is the left hand side. Now what we will do, we will divide both sides by psi r into ft. If we divide both sides of the equation by psi r into ft, then right hand side will become I h cut 1 by ft df by dt, because at that time psi r will be cancelled out. Similarly, in the right hand side, when we will divide by psi r into ft, ft will be cancelled out and the right hand side will become 1 by psi third, in the third bracket, the Hamiltonian operator that will act on psi r. This is the right hand side. Now note that the left hand side depends only on time t. You see the structure on the left side. This only depends on time t, and the right hand side only on r. You see the structure of the equation in the right hand side. There is no time here. So right hand side of the equation depends only on r. Therefore, both sides must be equal to a constant. We shall denote this constant by E. E is a constant, and we shall see shortly that this constant is equal to the energy of the particle. But right now, if we equate this equal to E, then from the left hand side we can write that is I h cut df by dt is equal to E into ft, and from the right hand side of the equation, if we equate the right hand side with E, then we will obtain minus h cut square by 2m del square plus vr into psi r, that is h into psi r. This is actually h, Hamiltonian operator h. H into psi is equal to E into psi. So we will obtain two sets of equation. Now, the first of these equation depends only on the time t. You see that first equation depends only on the time t. And if we integrate this equation, then we obtain ft is equal to e to the power minus I t by h cut. So, solving the first equation, we obtain ft is equal to this one. And the second equation, this second equation depends only on the space coordinate. You see there is no time coordinate here. So, this equation, the second equation, is known as the time independent Schrodinger equation. The solution of this equation depends particularly on the form of the potential Vr. You see in this equation there is potential energy V, and this potential energy will be different for different cases. So, depending upon the form of the potential, we will obtain the different solution of psi. Once this is done, that is once we solve this equation, the second equation, so ultimately we can obtain the full solution of the time dependent Schrodinger equation, which I have already shown in the beginning of the lecture. So, solution of that equation will be ultimately we can write, that is psi r t is equal to psi r into f t, but f t is equal to this one, that is e to the power minus I t by h cut. So, this is the full solution of this equation. But again, I am repeating that psi r will depend on the form of the potential V r, and depending upon the cases, we will obtain different types of the solution of the Schrodinger equation. So, we can write the second equation, that is time independent Schrodinger equation, as h into psi is equal to e into psi, because this is the Hamiltonian operator. So, h psi is equal to e psi, this is the structure of the time independent Schrodinger equation, and I have already told that h is equal to minus h cut square del square by 2m plus vr. This is known as the Hamiltonian operator. Now, if we again look at this equation, that is h psi is equal to e psi, then we can say that the operator h acting on the function psi gives back the same function multiplied by the constant e. Because you see h into psi is equal to e into psi. In the both sides of this equation there is psi, same function. But as h is acting on psi, it is giving some constant into psi. E is that constant. And this equation, that is such types of equation, are known as the eigenvalue equation. The function psi is called an eigenfunction of the operator h. So, the function psi is known as the eigenfunction of the corresponding operator h, and e is the corresponding eigenvalue. In general, many eigenfunctions and eigenvalues may correspond to a given h. It may happen that there are many eigenfunctions and eigenvalues that may correspond to a given h. The set of all the eigenvalues is called the eigenvalue spectrum of H. Since H is the Hamiltonian, we have already told that H operator is the Hamiltonian operator, and in the classical mechanics, we have already read that a Hamiltonian operator represents the total energy. So, the eigenvalues E are called the energy eigenvalues, because these are the possible energies of the system to indicate that an eigenfunction corresponds to a particular eigenvalue En. We put a subscript n with psi r, and that is we write it as psi n of r. It means that h into psi n r, that will be equal to En into psi n r. En indicates that it is the eigenvalue corresponding to the eigenfunction psi n r. So, we often give a subscript n in the eigenfunction to indicate that there is a particular eigenvalue En corresponding to psi n r. For example, suppose h of psi 1 r is equal to E1 psi 1 r, h of psi 2 r is equal to E2 psi 2 r, h of psi 3 r is equal to E3 psi 3 r in this way. So, that means that for a particular value of the eigenfunction, we are obtaining a particular value of the a particular eigenvalue. So, the thing is that eigenvalue en corresponds to the eigenfunction psi n r. Now we will discuss about the topic degeneracy. Suppose h into psi 1 is equal to e into psi 1. I have already discussed that h is the Hamiltonian operator. So h is acting on psi 1 and that is giving a particular eigen value of e. Now it may happen that although we are changing the eigen function, that is first time it is psi 1, then you are operating h on psi 2. So after operation of h on psi 2, it is again giving the same energy value e. So h of psi 2 is again e into psi 2. Then suppose h is acting on a third wave function, that is psi 3, and again it is giving the same eigen value e. H of psi 4 is equal to e into psi 4, h of psi 5 is equal to e into psi 5. In this way, h into psi k is equal to e into psi k. So suppose there are k sets of eigen function, and in each case, whenever h is acting on this wave function, it is giving you the same eigen value. So in that case, we say that the eigen value is degenerate. So if there are k linearly independent eigen function corresponding to the same eigen value e, then we will say that this eigen value is k fold degenerate. It can be easily shown that any linear combination of the degenerate eigen functions is also an eigen function corresponding to the same eigen value. So if we say that if psi 1 comma psi 2, in this way psi k, are linearly independent eigen functions corresponding to an eigen value e, then psi is equal to c1 psi 1 plus c2 psi 2 plus dot 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 plus ck psi k is also an eigen function corresponding to e. So this is the concept of degeneracy, and we can that is mathematically verify this statement. And that is, suppose you construct a Schrodinger equation by considering the wave function as psi 1, and next you consider again the Schrodinger equation by considering the wave function psi 2. Next you consider the wave function in the context of the wave function psi, which is equal to c, c1 psi 1 plus c2 psi 2. So you will see that Schrodinger equation will be satisfied by psi. So if the Schrodinger equation is separately satisfied by psi 1 and psi 2, then it must be satisfied by psi is equal to c1 psi 1 and c2 psi 2. I will advise the students to verify it mathematically. It is very easy to show. Now let us discuss another topic, which is the reality of the eigen values. We shall prove that all the energy eigenvalues are real and mention its consequences. Suppose E be the eigenvalue corresponding to an eigenfunction psi. So then what will happen? H into psi will be E into psi, where H is the Hamiltonian operator and E is the eigenvalue. Now we have already discussed that Hamiltonian H is a Hermitian operator. So from the property of the Hermitian operator, we can write, you see in the left hand side, it is integration of psi star H into psi into dr, and in the right hand side, we have written integration of H psi star psi dr. It is possible to write in this way because you think that H psi star, so it will give you psi star into H star. But H star is equal to H because H is the Hermitian operator. So we can write this equation in this way. So this equation will give, you see that in the left hand side, it is psi star H psi dr. Now we know that H psi is equal to E psi. So in place of H psi, I am writing in the left hand side psi star E psi dr. And in the right hand side, we are writing in this way. You see that h psi star will give you psi star h star. So psi star h star, h star means e star. I can write e star. So e star psi into dr. Now if you place the expression of the right hand side in the left hand side, so after the subtraction it will give you e minus e star integration of psi star psi dr is equal to 0. Now you consider this factor, that is integration of psi star psi into dr. So this is actually the probability integral, and this probability integral is necessarily positive, because probability must be positive. So this cannot be 0. Then e minus e star, that must be 0. So e is equal to e star, and as e is equal to e star, so we can say that eigenvalues of h are always real. Now we will discuss about the topic stationary states. An important consequence of the reality of eigenvalues that we have already discussed is that position probability density corresponding to the states represented by separable wave functions that we have already shown is independent of time. So what is the statement? The statement is that position probability density represented by the separable wave function is independent of time. Now what is the position probability density? We can write position probability density p is equal to psi star rt into psi rt. We have also discussed about this factor probability density. So p can be represented as psi star into psi. Now what is the expression of psi? We have already discussed that for separable wave function, we can write psi rt, that is full solution of the time dependent Schrodinger equation, can be expressed as psi rt is equal to psi r e to the power minus I e t by h car. So psi star into psi, that will become ultimately psi star e to the power I e t by h car into psi r e to the power minus I e t by h car. So this multiplication will give you psi star into psi. So this is the expression for the position probability density. Now you see that in the right hand side there is no time. The right hand side only depends on the position vector r. So the conclusion is this, that the position probability density is independent of time. As the position probability density is independent of time, that is why the states represented by the function psi rt are stationary states. Stationary states means those states that are independent of time. And this name is further justified by the fact that the expectation value of the total energy operator in a state described by the wave function is equal to the energy eigenvalue of that state for all time. Let's focus on the sentence, that is for all time. So what is the meaning of the statement? It will be clarified after the mathematical operation. So what we have to do, we have to calculate the expectation value of the total energy operator. In our earlier lecture, we have already described, that is how to calculate the expectation value. So our first task is to calculate the expectation value of the total energy operator H. So this is the expression for the expectation value. This is integration of psi star h psi dr. This is the expression to calculate the expectation value of h. Now we already discussed the expression of psi rt for the separable wave function. So after you express the wave function psi in its full form, that is psi r e to the power minus I e t by h cut. So first factor psi star rt will become psi star r e to the power I e t by h cut, then it is h, and psi rt is equal to psi r e to the power minus I e t by h cut into dr. Now you see in this expression there is a factor h into psi, so we can write h into psi as e into psi, and the exponential factors will be cancelled out. So ultimately what we will obtain, psi star r e into psi into dr. Now we will obtain, that is, we can write E outside of the integration as it is a constant. So E integration of psi star psi into dr is equal to E, because this psi r is normalized. So ultimately, you see the expectation value is the value of the energy. So this is a constant, the result is a constant, and it does not depend on time. So what we can say that for all time the expectation value of the total energy operator is equal to the energy eigenvalue, and this is for all time because it is independent of time. So from this facts we can say that the states represented by the wave function psi rt are stationary states. Now we will discuss about the topic orthogonality of eigenfunctions. Another important result is that the eigenfunctions corresponding to distinct eigenvalues are orthogonal. You focus on the words distinct eigenvalues. At first we have discussed about degenerate eigenvalues, but this is distinct eigenvalues. So what are distinct eigenvalues? We will discuss with example. Suppose psi k and psi n be the eigenfunctions corresponding to the eigenvalues ek and en respectively. So we can write h into psi k, that is equal to ek into psi k, and h into psi n, that is equal to en into psi n. Now you see that ek and en, they are not same. So that is why we have said initially that these eigenvalues are distinct. If it was degenerate, then what would happen? They will be same, that is ek is equal to en. But we have assumed that the eigenvalues are distinct in nature. So we have written in this way, that is one is ek and another eigenvalue is en. Now taking a complex conjugate of the second equation, that is this equation, and remembering that en is real, we know that energy is real, we have already derived earlier. So after taking the complex conjugate of the second equation, we obtain h of psi n star is equal to en psi n star. And now what we will do, pre-multiplying equation 6.67, that means this equation, by psi n star, we will multiply this equation by psi n star. And how we will multiply? Pre-multiplying. And post-multiplying this equation by psi k, that is, we will multiply this equation by psi k, but this is post multiplication. So let us see what we have obtained. You see that pre multiplying psi n star with the first equation will give you psi n star h of psi k is equal to ek psi n star psi k. Pre multiplying means you have to write psi n star before, then the next factors. Similarly, after the post multiplication of this equation, we have obtained h of psi n star psi k is equal to en psi n star psi k. Now what we will do, our next task is to subtracting this equation, and after subtracting we will integrate. So at first we will subtract, then we will integrate. So let us see what we have obtained. So you see, in the left hand side, ek minus en integration of psi n star psi k into dr, that is this side you have subtracted. So this factor is common, psi n star psi k is common. You see that psi n star psi k is common, and you are integrating it with respect to dr. And in the right hand side, this subtraction is there, that is psi n star h psi k minus h of psi n star psi k dr. This is the right hand side. Now if we look very carefully, you see, you just look at this factor, this one. So h of psi n star, this will give you psi n star h star, but h star is equal to h. So psi n star h into psi k, and this is also psi n star h into psi k. So basically first term and the second term, they both are same. So ultimately the right side is zero. Now the left hand side must be zero, as the right hand side is zero. So we have written the equation in this way. And since ek is not equal to en, we have already assume that the eigenvalues are distinct. So Ek is not equal to En. That means this can't be zero. So the integration psi k star psi n into dr, that is zero. So if integration of psi k star psi n dr is equal to zero, then we can say that the eigenfunctions are orthogonal in nature. And if an eigenvalue is degenerate, then the corresponding eigenfunctions are not necessarily orthogonal. We have already said that Ek not equal to En, but it may happen sometime that if Ek is equal to En, that is for the case of degeneracy. So in that case, the first factor is zero. If the first factor is zero, then we can't predict about the second factor, because the first factor zero means it may be zero, because zero into zero is equal to zero, but zero into some other factor is also zero. So at that time, it is difficult to predict that the eigenfunctions are orthogonal or not. But we can say that if the eigenfunctions are normalized, and then combining the normalization condition, we can write integration of psi k star psi n into dr is equal to delta k n. Because if k is equal to n, if k is equal to n, then this delta function will be 1. That is the condition for normalization. But in other case, this will give you 0. So this equation gives you the orthonormality condition. Now we will discuss about a topic about parity. Before proceeding further, it is necessary to introduce the listeners to the important concept of parity. So what is the concept of parity? For simplicity, we shall discuss the one-dimensional case. Suppose the potential function is symmetric about the origin, that is, it is an even function. Vx is equal to V of minus x. So this is the example of symmetric function. Vx is equal to V of minus x, and it is also called even function. This is an even function. Symmetric function, even function. And let us study the behavior of the Schrodinger equation under the operation of reflection through the origin. That is, if we put x is equal to minus x, then what will happen to the case of Schrodinger equation? And we know that the Schrodinger equation is minus h cut square by 2n d square psi by dx square plus vx into psi x is equal to e into psi x. Here we have not considered the time dependence. We are considering only the position dependence. We have not written time factor. So this is the Schrodinger equation, and if we replace x by minus x, so what will happen? This x will be minus x, this x will also be minus x, and this x will also be minus x. But you see, here is vx, but we should write that v of minus x here. But the point is that v of minus x is equal to vx. So we have written this as vx. Comparing these equations, we note that psi x and psi of minus x are eigenfunctions corresponding to the same eigenvalue e, because you see this operator, that is minus h cut square by 2m d square by dx square plus vx, this is the Hamiltonian operator. In the first equation, Hamiltonian operator acts on psi, and this gives us e into psi. But in the second case, Hamiltonian operator acts on psi of minus x, and it gives e of psi of minus x. So the meaning is that both equation psi x and psi of minus x are the eigenfunctions corresponding to the same energy eigenvalue e. Now there are two possible cases. The first case is that the eigenvalue is non-degenerate, then psi x and psi of minus x can differ only by a multiplicative constant, because the eigenvalue is non-degenerate. So at that time, psi of minus x can be c into psi x. And if we change the sign of this equation, it will be psi of x is equal to c of psi of minus x. Now if we substitute the value of psi x here, or value of psi minus x here, we can obtain that is psi x is equal to c square into psi x. So ultimately c square is equal to 1, or C is equal to plus minus 1. So from this two equation, if we consider this as the first equation, and if we consider this as the second equation, and in the second equation, if we substitute the value of psi of minus x, which is C into psi x, so we will obtain C into psi x, that is C square into psi x. So ultimately C is equal to plus minus 1. So from the first equation, we can say that psi of minus x is equal to plus minus psi x. This shows that the eigenfunction can be divided into two classes. The first one is that psi of minus x is equal to psi x, and it is said that this equation has even parity, and the other equation is psi of minus x is equal to minus psi x, and this equation has the odd parity. If the eigenvalue is degenerate, then psi of minus x need not be a multiple of psi x as in the previous cases. In that case, psi x and psi of minus x are two linearly independent solutions corresponding to the same eigenvalue. Therefore, any linear combination of psi x and psi of minus x is also a possible eigenfunction. We have already discussed about this fact. So we can choose two linear combination, that is psi plus x, and we are writing is as psi x plus psi of minus x, and next psi of minus x, that is equal to psi x minus psi of minus x. Clearly, psi plus x has even parity, while psi of minus x has odd parity. So what we have proved, that for symmetric potential, the eigenfunctions of the one-dimensional Schrodinger equation can always be chosen to have some definite parity. It may be even parity or it may be odd parity. This is the end of the lecture, and thank you for listening. And for further discussion in this topic, I request you to go through the textbook for undergraduates by M.C. Jain. Thank you again.